And we only talk about young people as consumers and those who need to be educated to become workers. But what about the notion that young people can be owners, trendsetters, innovators, and wealth builders? But not traditional wealth builders on their own terms. That's what our discussion is about today. Before I kick it to our wonderful MC, Miss Lissa Jones, where you at, Lissa? Come on, come on screen. I'd like to acknowledge Living Cities, who inspired Youthprise and the City of Minneapolis to be more bold and intentional in addressing equity and ownership and wealth building. They supported research that you'll learn about conducted by FSG. And we've been a part of a cohort of communities across the country looking at ownership and wealth building. So thank you, Living Cities, for that support. Hey, Lissa, where you at?
I'm here. So I don't know if you can't see me, but I'm here.
So good to see you. I know you continue to do wonderful things in the community. I just can't keep up. Glad to have you as our MC for another Disrupting with Purpose. And I'm super excited about this discussion around youth entrepreneurship, wealth building.
President Pope, I couldn't be more excited. I'm so delighted to be the facilitator again today. Every one of these events with Disrupting with Purpose has done something to transform my thinking. And that means every place I go, young people have been able to influence and transform other people's thinking because of what I've learned here. I know today will be no exception. So thank you for having me. I also think it's very cool to start out a meeting in any place where the song is, "I hope your flowers bloom." You know, I think the whole world could use songs like that. Every day we'd be nicer people. All right, off my soapbox, let's get it started because I'm not the one you're here to hear from. So let's start it off first with Essence Blakemore. She is a member of the staff at Youthprise, and we are excited to offer this piece of her spoken word. Welcome, Essence.
Hello, everyone. My name is Essence Blakemore. I'm a Youth Innovation Associate here at Youthprise, and I'm also just a community servant overall, so you may find me in a few different spaces. But today I came to share a poem that I created called No Vision, and without further ado, I will jump into it. Is there a reason for a vision when people like me, where I come from, have no say in the decision? We want to change the looks, narratives, and stigmas. We fighting against Black men not being humanized in hoodies. These are our dilemmas. We know how to apply for assistance, but not register for school and to vote. We say we want to liberate the people, but in reality, we offer a false hope. Creating change is a lot harder than it should be, just the way the forefathers always planned it would be. To bring change, this body has to talk to this body, and this body has to talk to the next. This is how authenticity gets lost within the text. I think y'all call that bureaucracy. Invested interest in keeping the language complicated and complex. I don't see a system. I see barriers. You want to be equitable and engaged, but classifying me as marginalized or POC. What are you saying? Do you even see me? I don't see a system. I don't see a system working with us. I see us working ourselves in. Because unfortunately, my seat and volume at the table is determined by the color of my skin. But I'm determined to educate my people because it's time we see a real win. But since you asked, I'll tell you my vision. It requires us to practice equity like a religion. I see us having conversations about something that's real. I want to bring about change that the people can feel. I see Black men in crisp suits with their dreads braided to the back. I see sis at the table with her colorful nails and weaves not feeling self-conscious for looking too Black. I see universal love and a general understanding. I see generational traumas actually being addressed. But again, with everything I've said, thank you for the space and time to express. Is there a reason for a vision? Thank you. I appreciate the space to share that piece of art with you all. I hope the rest of the session goes amazing, and I depart from you all sending love and peace. So until next time, and continue finding ways to disrupt these systems.
Essence Blake Moore, I hope your flowers continue to grow. That is outstanding. The thoughts and the ideas from our young people are absolutely profound. We need to learn and listen and heed and do. It's now my pleasure, thanking Essence, to let you know that we will have at a later date a recording, a longer recording of what's about to come up next. In fact, let me welcome Wahia Murdaugh and Kendra Berenson to join us in their presentation. Welcome.
Hi, my name is Wahia Amarda. I'm a senior consultant with FSG, and I am so thrilled to be recording this for the Youthprise conference. I know it's going to be amazing, and I'm so excited to just share all of the really amazing work that we've done with Youthprise and the city of Minneapolis. So meet the FSG team, Kendra Berenson, Chris Carlson, Jeff Cohen, and myself, Wahia Murdaugh. The team, including myself and the senior leaders on the screen, have served as thought partners and guides throughout our work. I am also very grateful to other members of the FSG team who contributed to this work, including Victor Tavares and Anthony Zhang. A little bit more about me. I'm based out of Washington, DC. I'm originally from the Bronx, New York. My background is in government and community engagement, and I am so passionate about equitable economic development for Black and Brown communities. So I was super excited to have the opportunity to fuse my interests together through this project. I'm going to dive into what we heard from the young people. During our focus group with the youth, we talked about how they defined wealth for themselves, their communities, their families, and the quotes from the focus group, as I mentioned, are really the most powerful part of the assessment. So I'm going to read a lot of those as we go through the rest of the presentation, but it really just is a reflection of how tapped in and connected the youth are to what's happening in their own communities. Participants believe that wealth went beyond finances and extended to access, opportunity, and time. There was an emphasis on collective wealth, providing for community and others, and ensuring that wealth building was not exploitive, I thought that was incredibly powerful, that the young people were already thinking about this work with a collective mindset, with a community mindset, were already conscious of some of the challenges that come with wealth, and wanted to make sure that they were being, that in the event they had the opportunity to access wealth, there was a responsibility to be conscious of how you managed it. Participants did not desire to be rich, but rather wanted to be able to meet their needs comfortably and have a little extra to enjoy life and support their community. Wealth and community meant that a community had a good quality of life and had all of their needs met. And so some of the quotes included, "Wealth can look like money, but I think wealth ultimately is having the means to pour resources into solving a problem or into a community that needs more of something, or infrastructure for people, and generally just building people's means of happiness." I thought that was amazing. Another person said, "I've personally been thinking about the definition of wealth as also the ability to have access to anything. It's really about having access to that education, to the necessities of life, or access to having a hobby, the access to have time, as we talked about earlier. Oh, and one thing I really want to add, I think another part of wealth is who you know is exactly what you have." Another really powerful quote, young people are already thinking about the fact that wealth goes beyond dollars, right? It's having access to things, to places, to time to spend with your family, with your loved ones. And so I thought it was just really cool that those distinctions were made in the conversations they were having. For a lot of communities that experienced structural inhibitors to that, to accessing home ownership, we don't have anything to pass down. And so I think it was really important to name, again, the varying experiences for people. And then when you do have access to ownership, how you maintain that, how do you convince families that it is important to keep it in the family, and just how to manage it or use it for passive income. I really appreciated that participants named the history of racist policies as a major contributor to home ownership disparities. Again, just going back to systems thinking, we are being conscious and considerate of the history that got us here. And we're not blaming the individual, but we are placing a very intentional light on how these systems have and are working together. They recognize the criminal justice system as a major barrier for BIPOC communities, which I thought was so powerful. And participants feel like the standards for them as BIPOC youth have always been different. So one quote says, I think it's very obvious how all of these things are intertwined. We talked about education. In our group, we were talking about redlining, how historically Black people have been pushed out of neighborhoods, right? Like white people, white flight, white people have ran away from cities to live in the suburbs and to move away from majority Black populations. I think that's kind of the same thing. Not the same thing, but it's the aftermath. Dealing with the aftermath of race and racism, Black people continuing to be pushed out. Capturing it so perfectly, like the history of redlining and just historical disinvestment in Black communities cannot be understated. And so I thought it was incredibly powerful that the young people are already thinking about how this history is really playing a role in what they're seeing today and still impacting their experiences. Another quote said, because white people are having money conversations at the dinner table, they're leaving insurance down to their kids, they're leaving all this stuff. And because Black and brown people have never really had the opportunities where they've been pushed out of opportunities time and time again, we can't even have those conversations at the dinner table. What are we going to talk about? What are we going to talk about? Another extremely powerful quote. And really just, again, like there's the generational wealth that's in the form of, a home or something physical that's being passed down. But that generational knowledge and just information is so powerful. Jumping into entrepreneurship, we talked a lot about some aspects of entrepreneurship and just wealth building when we talked through the home ownership stuff. But I think the main takeaway when we discussed barriers for youth entrepreneurs is that many participants who were entrepreneurs were at different stages of their journeys, but all wish that they had more guidance, support, resources, and the space to make mistakes and learn from them. And so some of the quotes said, you know, nobody can teach you the way mistakes can teach you. And when you have a support system that can catch you when you're falling and provide financial resources to help you build your business back if you make a mistake is a huge, huge, huge resource, right? And so you have the space to make mistakes in a way that a lot of other people don't. And in this case, a lot of Black and brown young entrepreneurs do not have that safety net that a lot of other white or more privileged entrepreneurs might have. And so they don't have the space to make the same mistakes. And so they can't learn at the same rate or the same way that others are. BIPOC entrepreneurs are over-mentored and under-invested. So to be honest, everybody wants to be a mentor. And I think mentors are important, but we do have to recognize when someone's getting advice and advice and advice and advice and advice and never a chance. I think that's so powerful, right? There's a difference between a faux investment and real investment. And sometimes people, you know, act like they're committed to the cause or are willing to support. But when it comes to actually investing, putting the money up, putting the capital, connecting to resources, a lot of BIPOC entrepreneurs are left out of the conversation. Or just to the point of the quote, over-mentored and not actually given the shot, not actually given the resources. And then the last quote says, so I got a small business I've run for like 4 years. I find it's almost entirely just problem solving and just committing to it. Like you were saying, you just gotta say F it and go forward. And so again, when you don't have access to a safety net or you know, some of those spaces where you learn more or just access to people who have run a business before, you're learning a lot of this as you go. And so big kudos to the BIPOC entrepreneurs that are doing it, that are killing it. But it is incredibly hard when you are learning and solving problems on your own as you go. Big thank you to Living Cities, to the City of Minneapolis, Youthprise, to all of the partners who have been just incredibly helpful throughout this process, who have helped us create an assessment to be proud of, one that I hope sees, you know, longevity. Big thank you to the young people who laid it out on the table for us, who were very honest and transparent, and just so really gave powerful perspectives on their communities, on their worlds. And I am so excited to see what comes from all this work that you all have been doing.
I am so excited, not about the idea of our difficulties, but about the idea that young people recognize it doesn't have to stay this way. When she said we are over-mentored and under-invested in, I mean, I had to turn my camera back on. That was so profound. Let me thank Wahira Marda. Thank you so much. And let me welcome Kendra Berenson, Associate Director of FSG. I want to welcome you, Kendra, to share your perspectives. Audience, please feel free to share any questions you have for Kendra in the chat, and we'll do our best to get them for you, get answers for you. In the meantime, welcome, Kendra.
Thanks. Great to be here. I know Wahira would have loved to be here, but she is out of town this week. But so glad I could be here. Happy to answer any questions that might be coming up.
Fantastic. Let me ask, what would you want us to know most about the data that you have, that Wahira has been able to present? What do you want us to know? What do you want us to take away?
Yeah, I think one thing that I was just so moved by was the vision of what is possible in terms of a really expansive vision of what wealth is. There was so much of a sense of caring for the community, not just caring for the individual, sense of sustainability. So how do we not just build something now, but how do we build something for the future, for our family, for the next generation, for our community? There was a real sense of possibility with what could be created by youth who are living together, working to create together, co-creating something together. And I think a really holistic sense of what health and well-being is. So Wahira mentioned a lot of that through the quotes, but just the sense of, is there a space for us to be creative? Is there a space for us to learn together and build these relationships? Is there space to support each other in our entrepreneurial endeavors? So all of the above.
Thank you. You know, I was thinking back to Essence's presentation on her spoken word. I mean, if I'm BIPOC, do you even see me? I mean, we're not BIPOC, and we don't live in communities of color. We live in neighborhoods. And did that come through in your research that people, language matters, and how we're identified and how we identify ourselves also matters?
Yeah, I think that absolutely came through. I think there were both really painful examples of people sharing ways that their identities had limited the opportunities they had, limited the ways that they were perceived, for example, in a bank applying for a loan, where they felt that their humanity was actually not being recognized. They weren't being given the same access to information about how to apply for a loan, et cetera. But then I think on the flip side, a sense of really the richness of community and the multiple identities that people are bringing.
I thank you, Kendra. You know, as a way of transitioning to our panel, I'd like to ask you, if we have audience members who want to take something meaningful away from the data and your research, what do you want us to take away? What do you want us to tell community?
Yeah, it's a great question. So one thing is that we will be sharing back the full report that came out of this research with all those who participated. And I know Living Cities is also going to work to make that available to others. So know that that is coming if you want to get more detail. I think the other thing that I would offer is just really an opportunity to learn about wealth building, learn about the systems and how they work, that knowledge is power. And I think something that really came forward through the research, through this process, was the more that we can have direct conversations about what are the systems that shape homeownership, entrepreneurship, how do they work? What are the different pieces? What do you need to know? What's the process? Who do you need to talk to? What are some of the challenges? So really just breaking it down, sharing the information with each other is so powerful. And I think that creates a sense of what could be possible instead of a sense that this cannot be possible or this has not been possible.
I want to say thank you. Thank you for your collaborative work. Thank you for bringing this research to the fore. And thank you so much for being here today. We are very, very grateful. Kendra Berenson, I appreciate you. And now,
thank you.
It is now my privilege to bring forward our panelists for this afternoon. I want to know what they're thinking. I want to know what they're thinking about the data and so much more. I have the pleasure of welcoming Kashua Vu, Cole Stevens, Athena Estime, Alondra Alamia, and Maya Williamson. I think our other two panelists may join us in the future, but I don't think they're here with us right now. So first, let me welcome each of you to the floor. Welcome and come on in. Let's, if we can, start out with the youngest member of our panel, Miss Maya, along with her mother. Is it Brianna?
Yes.
Well, welcome. You have the loveliest background for your two wonderful selves. I'm so excited to talk with you today. How are you, Maya?
I'm good.
Wonderful, wonderful. I want to know, what made you decide to kick off a business? And what do you want us to know about you, Maya?
That I am 7 years old and I have been a kidpreneur for almost 3 years.
A kidpreneur.
Oh my God!
Don't read the comments, just talk.
I love to read books. I love my natural hair and I want everybody to love their natural hair too.
And is that what got you excited to write books?
Yes. My parents and I published our first book when I was 4 years old.
When did you learn to read, Maya?
4 years old.
My goodness, you are smart. Do you have plans to write more books?
Yes.
How many books have you written?
14.
Did you say you wrote twice the number of books as the number of years you've been on this earth?
Yes.
I am so proud of you, Maya.
Yes, I'm going to show some, actually.
I love it.
This is the first book that I've made with my parents.
What's it called?
Natural Hair ABCs.
I love natural cups.
There's a coloring book where I have these little Christmas ornaments on my hair, but my mom, when she was making the book, she changed it to little things because we're inspired
planets.
Little planets because we're inspired by Tabitha Brown.
And what's this book called?
Making Change. And my favorite book of all, The Ballerina Who Lost Her Fro. It's about me!
The Ballerina Who Lost Her Fro. Tell us a little bit about it, Maya.
What's this book about?
This book is about, me.
You went to ballet school.
I went to ballet and I didn't want to wear my bun because I was like, Mom, my hair is my crown, and I don't need a bun. They pull on my edges and are just no fun.
So what did you want to wear to ballet? You wanted to wear your afro?
I wanted to wear my afro, and at the end, I'm going to show you what happened. I'm going to go to the page, which is way back.
I can help you.
Yeah.
So you danced your heart out anyways, even though you didn't they wanted you to wear a bun, and then what happened?
So you see... So you see the beginning, which is right here. It goes. So I come in, it snaps, and then I'm surprised.
Your ponytail holder snaps.
Yep, my ponytail holder snaps poof.
And then you get your afro back.
Yep, poof. My afro big. Actually, in real life, it's gigantic.
Maya, we are so proud of you. When you get a chance to see all of the chat comments, you are going to be so excited about your success. Where can we buy your books?
Someone said, where do we buy? And someone said, I want her book.
Where did they buy your book?
At www.lovemynatural.com.
If
anyone hears me, it's www.lovemynatural.com. If you want to search it after this panel, you are sure to.
If anybody on this Zoom can resist this young lady, I don't know who it is. Well, thank you, Maya. Thank you, Maya, and thank you, Brianna. I'm so glad you're both here. Thank you very much. I want you to think about the fact that she said she's 7 years old and she's been a kidpreneur for 3 years. Entrepreneurship can start at any age, and what an inspiration. I know I have books to buy. I'm going to be looking up the website in about 2 minutes as soon as we get off this call. In the meantime and in between time, come on in, panelists, Kashua and Cole, Alondra and Athena, welcome too. I'd like to know, what do you think about the data? What did you get from it? Anyone can respond. I forgot to click the hand thing.
I think the just over mentored and under invested. My name is Kashua Vu. I created the female empowerment program Dream Big, and I really just created it because I was a part of like a lot of really cool opportunities throughout my high school and college career, and I kept finding that my female friends just couldn't join me. They couldn't do it. There were so many barriers and stuff that they couldn't do it. They had family obligations. They had work obligations. I found that the women in my life were they were giving so much to their communities that they couldn't invest in themselves. There was no time for mistakes. There was no time for curiosity. There was no really room to dream and create the lives that they wanted. So I was like, you know what? Like, I'm tired of being alone. I want my friends to be with me. I want women and girls that are younger than me, older than me, to reclaim their lives for themselves and like really get a chance to dream big. So I've created a travel fund and also a safe, like a really cool space for us to come together and rest and really invest in ourselves and really decide for women what they want for themselves and what life they want for themselves. So I just saw a need in my community, and it's been so cool to see people invest in themselves when other people haven't done that for them, or like they haven't had the time. So I just think that's something that kind of stuck out to me that I felt compelled to be a part of.
I'm so glad that you were inspired to start your organization. And I think you are right. The time to rest, the time to make mistakes is also a part of wealth, right? Yeah, that's such a profound observation. Thank you. Cole Stevens, welcome to it. Let's talk a little bit about you and your business and what sparked you to get involved. What do you think about the data?
There we go. Now I'm on. Absolutely. Thank you so much, Lissa. And also just a huge shout out to Youthprise and Marcus for bringing forth this new vision, really including young people and sort of entrepreneurship, wealth building and ownership. You know, super excited about that. So I'm Cole Stevens. I'm an artist. I'm a community organizer and a serial entrepreneur. I wear a lot of hats. I co-founded a company called Club Concrete, which if you think about it, it's kind of like a country club, but for the inner city kids like myself who are creative. So we're a collective of creatives, artists, and really we're trying to get that young person who's about to take their art to the next level of seriousness and the next level of quality. So we're a recording studio, an event space, and just all around a good time. And I would be in the studio right now today, but I still got to set up the Wi-Fi, but it's looking nice. So catch us in downtown St. Paul, where we're going to have our opening ceremony. There's my LinkedIn in the chat, just so you guys can, you know, be, you know, updated on that. I'll put it in later. But anyway, what I really thought of the data goes back to what Marcus said. And this is just so obvious. I mean, young people, we're here to build wealth, but on our own terms, right? So we are not here to play into a machine that's just going to incentivize us to mindlessly consume. No, we are here to generate wealth for our families, for our communities, to invest that money into things that make our loved ones and the people around us their lives better. And so that's why I think we're here to build wealth. We want to do it differently. We want to solve problems, and we want to improve people's quality of life with our businesses. And so that's really the whole reason for Club Concrete as a company, is that, you know, in the landscape we're in right now, creativity is about to be valued a lot more in the future here, as you know, the school system's not preparing us for these new jobs and this very fast-paced, quick thinking kind of economy. And it's coming. We've got, you know, the jobs being automated away, like truck driving and food service. We need to be ready for this. We need to be ready to tap into our creativity and really take the future by hold. So that's what we're doing, that's what we're preparing people to do with my company. Also another quick plug, Bridge Makers as well. That's a nonprofit that I have, and we work with Youthprise to, you know, help young people share their voice and leadership in the community. So yeah, super excited about this and super excited to be here with all these amazing panelists.
Fantastic. You two have me dreaming big about Club Concrete and so many other things, women's role in the world. It's wonderful. For the rest of our panelists, welcome Hajaratu. Is that how I say your name? Please tell me how to say it appropriately.
Yes, Hajaratu.
Hajaratu, welcome. We're delighted you're here. I'm going to open up this question to anybody on the panel, and thank you too for contributing. Let's talk about what wealth building means to you and why does it matter? And you can feel free, if you've not already spoken, to introduce a little bit about yourself and your business if you'd like when you're responding. The question is ultimately, what does wealth building mean to you and why does it matter? Thank you, Alondra. Welcome.
Hi, my name is Alondra. I am 20 years old and I am a photographer and videographer. So my business is a one-woman team, just myself, but I do photo sessions and event coverage. So for me as a photographer, wealth building is really just about accumulating those assets and those resources that I need very early, still in the stages of my career. I think all of the profits right now that I'm making is really just about gathering that equipment that I need. And it's not, to me, wealth building is not a tangible amount of currency. It's not what is reflected in your bank account, right? It's more about the building aspect, which is accumulating those assets and those resources. So it's not about the money itself. So for me, it's the profit that I'm turning over. It's not reflected in my bank account yet, but you can see it in the equipment that I've been able to afford, the lenses that I'm collecting, the hard drives that I'm investing in, the editing software I'm experimenting with. All of that isn't tangible cash, but it's part of the business that I'm building, which will eventually bring me my wealth. And it's important because you're learning how to save and invest. And I don't think that ever really stops. You always have to keep investing.
What excellent insights. Thank you, Alondra. I really appreciate that. Maya, drop it on me. What's up? What are your thoughts?
What does wealth building mean to you?
Wealth building means that I can have my own money. I can save up for houses I want. I can save up for college. And I can save up for my Tesla money car. And I also actually want three cars. So one of the cars is the Tesla, the pink Tesla, then a pink Lamborghini or a pink Volkswagen Beetle. I have a lot of cars that I want.
I love, can I get a ride in the Volkswagen Beetle? I think that would be so much fun. Plus, you're going to have a lot more books because you're going to have three garages. Mm-hmm. And then somebody had the nerve to say, let them hold a dollar. No, they did not, Maya.
If I have three family members that are adults, they can have two of my cars, but that Beetle was mine.
Yes. When I talk to her about wealth building, we sit down and we have meetings. So when she got the grant from Youthprise, we asked, what do you think you should do with it?
Actually, I'm going to say something. Thank you guys for the $3,000 grant, actually. Thank you.
Well, what did you want to do? You wanted to buy more products?
Yes, I wanted to buy more products. And so if I buy more products, it means I get more money. And the more the money, the better.
This is a very simple business strategy. Very brilliant, Maya. Very brilliant. Clearly your parents have it on the ball too. Clearly. Thank you so much. This is excellent. This is excellent. People are loving it all over the place. Next, let's talk about what do you feel are the barriers for young people, especially from diverse communities, in building intergenerational wealth for themselves, their families, and their communities? What are some of the barriers? Let's go to Athena and then we'll go to Cole. Thank you so much. Nice job, Maya and Mama.
Hello, everyone. My name is Athena Estime, and I'm also known as Vibrant Hughes, one of the co-founders of Creative Noir, the creative group me and Hajaratu have founded. Barriers for youth are something that our group is constantly trying to address in the community. And one is definitely space, not having really healthy spaces for us to interact that are for us and by us, lack of intergenerational spaces that allow various generations to connect and flow together. especially between like ethnic groups. There are a variety of Black groups here in Minnesota, Somali people, Nigerian people, Haitian people like Hajaratu and I. And we feel that if there were spaces that connected us all, really would like transform the community and how we connect and build wealth.
I'm so glad you're on the panel. Thank you, Athena. What fantastic insights. Thank you. This is wonderful. And Kashua, would you like to contribute as well?
Yeah, I think for young people, I think people don't realize how busy young people are. I feel like the mentality is that kids have all the free time in the world, and that's just not the case. Our kids are so busy nowadays. Because we're telling them they have to do all these things, and they're doing their best to do them. I would say also transportation, I think, is also a big barrier for young people. They want to be a part of things. And that's actually something that's been kind of nice out of the pandemic, is that access to things that you physically can't be there, or you don't have the means to get there. That's been really helpful. And then I think the financial piece, like I think that's also a barrier. A lot of young people can't work, or they're too busy to work, or things like that. So they don't have the financial means to invest in what they want to do with their lives. So those are the barriers that I see in my life and in the life of the young people that I work with.
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you, Kashua. Just going back a moment to Athena and really thinking about, there are still laws on the books against African-Americans being able to gather. So the idea that we could put all the people of the diaspora together would be a dream come true. I hope you'll invite me. And for you, Kashua, yes, all of those things are agency, right? The ability to build wealth helps us to break down barriers, to figure out new ways, to problem solve with different resources. Hajaratu, please pick it up.
Can you remind me of the question again or rephrase it?
What are the barriers that you see to building wealth for young people, especially young people from diverse communities? And what about building wealth for our families?
Well, I would say, like, just looking at with my, well, first of all, hello, my name is Hajaratu. and I am a co-founder of Creative Noir with Athena, aka Vibrant Hues. I am a creative director, model. I like to dibble and dabble into whatever I feel called to, and I love to help people. I would say from my experience in growing up is like building wealth is like also like having the capacity to do that, because, you know, not everyone has the privilege or the capacity to be able to be like, okay, let me think about like wealth and how to build that and how to maintain that and stuff like that. And like having more resources, something that I really would love to do just throughout my life, you know, before my next journey in this world, is to be able to create resources where people who might not have the capacity to be able to get the resources they need to grow that capacity to start thinking about the future, when the future is really maybe like, not really thinking about, or only thinking about the next day or a couple months, which is like a real reality for people. So I guess like I'm really privileged to be able to have the story that I have with my parents and the people I'm surrounded with, but it's not the case for everyone. So I think having that capacity is really important to do so.
I love it. Your idea is committing to community capacity building. Excellent. Welcome to the panel. I'm delighted you're here. Hi, Maya. I see you. I would not forget you. Thank you so much for raising your hand so I could see you properly. Welcome again, Maya. What are your ideas, please?
What are barriers for young people who want to start a business?
Not having people who believe in them, like not having enough support, not having enough money. Here's this thing that my dad showed me like yesterday. It said like, they didn't believe me, but God did.
And what does that mean to you?
if God believes in you, you just got to get some waiting time and patience, and then everybody can believe in you.
Wow, my goodness. You know, Frederick Douglass said it is easier to build strong children than it is to repair broken men. I would say that you are building strong children. Such a beautiful, it is so beautiful to hear you, Maya. Thank you for the inspiration. Your parents are so cool. Yes, right on. There's claps and snaps and everything happening everywhere. In my day, it was dap, but then this day it's claps and snaps, you know? So Alondra, what are your thoughts, please? And then we'll move to the next question.
Yeah, thank you. So I think for me, definitely what I see is that the biggest barrier is knowledge and simply having an example of what wealth is and what it can look like. So for me, being a child of immigrants and being an immigrant myself, wealth building looked a lot different for my parents. At first, the act of even just getting to the States was wealth building for them. And after that, it was just paycheck to paycheck. So circumstances are a huge barrier, but also knowledge, because after more than a decade of being here, my parents were able to try a different approach. Now they have their own business. So my dad does landscaping and he's doing what he loves, but it took a lot of time and learning the language, learning the limitations and loopholes, the logistics. But for me, seeing that example from them made all the difference. I wouldn't have started my own business this soon if I hadn't watched and learned from him. So that's everything, because not everyone is going to have that example and a lot of us don't. So that's a huge barrier, knowing what's possible and knowing where to start. And I think programs like this that invest in diverse individuals, you're investing in us, but you're also investing in people who look like us, and you're investing in our communities, what others might be able to learn from seeing us.
Yes.
Who just said yes? Let it flow. Who said that? Okay, I missed you. Whoever said that was yes.
I'm sorry, that was Miss Davis Carter. I just said yes. I'm sorry, I'm gonna be quiet. I'm sorry, I'm not following the rules. I'm sorry.
Thank you. No problem. I thought it was a panelist. Thank you so much for your grace. You know, Alondra, I think that's really critically important to think about. Circumstances matter, right? We have the big P policies that people write down, and the little P policies they often don't tell people who do not look one way, right? And then those are the places where we get killed on the rules, because didn't nobody tell us and we didn't know. And so then the knowledge, the lack of knowledge can be a killer. The lack of being able to see somebody who looks like us who's doing that is also a killer. Dr. Carter G. Woodson, who became the father of Black History Month, said, if you don't know, you lose the inspiration that comes from the learning of your biography and history. We have to see it so we can know we can be it. This is fantastic. All right, let's open it up to all of you. Thank you for the heart, Miss Alita. You're so beautiful. Okay, for the whole team, prep up. Let's talk about, what do you believe young people need? What do you need, and what do your communities need to have better overall economic well-being and opportunity? We have a little time for you to take your time, so please speak your piece. Cole, kick us off. Thank you kindly.
Absolutely. Thank you kindly. So this, number one, I just got to say, I hope y'all are taking notes, because we have been dropping gems, and Maya especially. It's been hard to keep up with you, Maya, I got to say. But I think I can drop a little something here, though. So what do I think young people need? We talked about over-mentored, under-invested, right? So we need the capital. We definitely need that, because the capital is a safety net for which to fail forward, right? So when you do have that, you can make those mistakes. And I got to say, start them early and make those mistakes fast and make them smart, all right? Fail forward, fail fast. And the reason that it's so important, you know, we talk about, what are the barriers for young people? What are the strengths of our young people? Well, the strengths of our young people is that we can take a lot. So we can keep failing, we can keep moving forward, and we can take those lessons super, super fast. So I think we have to understand our own strengths, is that we can really get into it and we can really, really, really learn quickly. So do it early. And then the other thing that I would say that young people need, we need to be mentored the right way, correct? So for our elders, for our adults, for our experienced people, you know, I think it's one of the most important things to teach a young person. You know, it doesn't start off with the logistics of business, right? It starts off with aligning in your purpose. It starts off with aligning in a vision that you have for yourself and for something greater than you. That's how all great entrepreneurs really create a difference and really build wealth, right? And so it took a mentor to tell me that I was doing too much, that I was working outside of my purpose. Yeah, they had a bag for me to do a little whatever, to do this, to go here. but not to get distracted and to stick with my purpose to move forward and to make, you know, my my highest impact. So, you know, for the adults and folks, go find a young person who's incredible, who's doing wonderful things, and help them focus, help them nail down their purpose and support them in that vision and that dream. Thank you, Megan.
Right on, Cole. That's what I'm talking about. Yes, help them align with their purpose. I also think that when you are assuming mentorship, assume the person has agency. Assume that you are just adding to what they have, that they don't have deficits you need to fill as the mentor. They're asking you to share what you have to help build their capacity. So we need to be thinking about how we're thinking about mentorship. What's up, Maya? What is your advice? Thank you, Cole. That was awesome.
Oh, you want me to go first?
Yes.
So I was just thinking, as her mother, when she was four, we had to be intentional about investing in her ideas before anyone else would. And listening when they speak, right? Natural hair is not something that stuck out to us. Writing children's books is not something that stuck out to us. But when we saw a void and saw this interest that she had, it was naturally something that we were happy to sit with her and learn and say, you're never too young to make change, right? It's never too early for us to invest in their ideas. And what do you think is important? What do young people
I think they need money to invest their businesses. I think they need people to help work with them, because when I had my store, I kept going out and I kept asking people, do you want to work with me? Do you want to be an employee? But no one wanted to come in my store. But then my daddy decided to help me, and then my mom.
And what she's talking about is the Mall of America gave her 6 months rent free, and we can only work so many hours between mom and dad. And so when she tried to hire, it was hard to find employees. Granted, we were doing it during a pandemic, but she was able to hold her own in the Mall of America for a whole year. And then it was just like, you'll get another store when you're able to work it yourself.
Yeah, I was able to work at the Mall of America for 1 year, but then I had to close it down. But why, Mom?
Because you don't have any employees and I'm too busy.
With your belly?
Yeah.
She's just going to take a break to make a life real quick and she'll be right back. Excellent wisdom from mother and daughter. Fantastic. Fantastic. Kashua, what do you think your community needs? What do young people need?
I think when you come from a community that's been oppressed, you really don't know how good life can be. Like, I found that's been true for, like, I think, like, and that's what the name of why my program is called Dream Big. Cause I remember, like, growing up, I had a dream. I was gonna have, like, travel is a big part of Dream Big. And when I was younger, I was like, oh my gosh, like, when I'm older, I want to be able to have a suitcase that has, like, all the stickers from all the countries, and maybe I'll travel the world when I'm, like, really old one day. And then I met someone who was around my age when I was about 18, 19. And he told me, like, yeah, I've gone to 3 countries this year. And I was like, you can go to 3 countries in 1 year? I didn't know someone could do that. So I think, like, you know, like, not knowing, I, you know, thinking that travel is for rich people, that you can only go on one trip a year. Then that's, like, the most amazing thing. Knowing that, you know, people are doing, you know, my dreams times, like, 3 or more. And so I think knowing that, and it's like, oh, well, and then, you know, rather than being defeated by knowing, like, oh, he goes on 3 trips a year, it's like, oh, well, how did you do that? You know, what can I do so I can also do that? And I think it's really important to see, like, how good life can be. Like, what can, like, how, like, maybe, like, you're dreaming of making 40K in your lifetime. Well, you know, so, you know, maybe you should dream bigger. Like, you know, you can think about making 50K, 100K, all these things. And you can, I don't know, I just think it's really important to see how good life can be. So yeah, that's what I think.
Outstanding. Thank you. And Alondra, what are your thoughts? What do young people need, and what would help build wealth in your community?
We need people to believe in us. That's all. We just need, a chance, need to give us a shot at it. So I'm just starting out with, I was doing photography in the beginning mostly, and then I want to be a filmmaker. That's why I started this. And knowing that the industry isn't always stable, there, you know, it's very much freelance all the time. So I just wanted something to fall back on, because there's nothing to fall back on. So that's where my business came in. But once I started doing videography, which I've only done a few weddings and quinceañeras, but that was this year. And, you know, I had to be truthful to my customers. I've never shot a wedding, but they gave me the chance and now I've shot a wedding. And that's all I needed. I just needed that one shot. So we just need people to believe in us and take a chance on us.
I think that's excellent. I think that's excellent. We all have needed somebody to believe in us. I have got nothing on my own. Athena, you're shaking your head. What do you think? Thank you, Alondra. What do you think? What do young people need? What do we do?
I definitely feel like young people need community and support, someone to bounce ideas off of, someone to kind of just run through all of their anxieties and processes. Especially as creatives, I think a lot goes into it. We wear many hats. We're the accountants, the facilitator sometimes, and also the artist and the performer, maybe depending on what you're doing. So having that guidance where it's like, oh, okay, this is the run of show, or this is how you structure your day so that you have enough time to do all the things and structure your year so that you can have quarterly goals and show up in community and show up for your creative practice while also balancing, sustaining yourself, having a conversation that allows young people to kind of offload, like, oh, okay, I have all these anxieties in my mind because I know I have to do a lot, but how do we break this up? How do we process this? And who can I go to help with accounting? Who can I go to help with finding a venue? And how can I build the community around me that can support my goals, essentially?
That is really great perspective. You know, I've been an entrepreneur for a long time and I never thought about, yeah, I'm an accountant, I'm a facilitator, I'm a file clerk, I'm a, you know, whatever I am, I'm a marketer, I'm all that. That's a really great insight, Athena. Thank you. Thank you. Hajaratu, would you like to drop in your thoughts about what do young people need and how can wealth building happen in your community? And we will go to the chat in a few minutes, Cole, so you can answer that question too.
I really agree with what Athena said about how we wear different hats in acknowledging that even if it is something that does come naturally, or it's just like, oh yeah, well, I just did this whole project and it's a lot of work. And so like, I think I agree with just like support and also like what Alondra said about someone giving you a chance to just do something. I think even just like right now, I'm curating a art show and you know, sometimes you kind of have to give yourself that chance to be able to do that and get some friends together. Like, hey, you know, you're interested in doing this. Come on, let's like do this project and like actually like get into it and kind of create that for yourself. And even if it is just like a collaboration, stuff like that. Like it's my first time being a creative director, but I have these skills and all these other things that I've done, you know, especially with Creative Noir and like hosting events and stuff. So I kind of gave myself that shot and whomever I saw, you know, really I felt like was like, you know, like either it's like their Instagram looks cool and it's like, okay, you've been taking those pictures, but so photographer, where you at? Like, you know, and like kind of seeing that in people and giving each other those chances too is like really big. So overall, I just love what everyone was saying about like, one, you know, acknowledging the many hats that we wear, two, giving each other that chance, or, you know, other people being open to giving people that their first chance. So it only takes one yes, you know? So yeah.
It only takes one yes. Excellent, thank you. From the audience, Cole, you indicated you wanted to respond to this and all of you are invited to answer. We still have a few minutes for our panel. What elements would you add to our communities and networks that would make youth entrepreneurship more of a systematic norm?
Absolutely. And so, you know, my other venture, which is a nonprofit organization, Bridge Makers, this is what we're doing, right? So we have a couple of things going on in the community. One of them is next March, we're going to be launching an entrepreneur fellowship. And what that is taking some foundational things of business and what's most important, actually getting out there, getting your hands dirty, spending some money, making some money, making mistakes, and doing entrepreneurship. So it's a 6-month program. Definitely check out boombridgemakers.com. It's going to launch in a little bit here, the application. So folks will be able to jump on there with a little bit of an idea or just really a great personality and an entrepreneurial background, and we'll help you shoot out the idea and get it running. And the other thing that we, I think, can work on collectively as we're all here is really just be interested in becoming either a mentee or a mentor, right? So that's another thing we're trying to build out here, is a bit of like a system for folks to just connect with people. We'll be trying to connect as many young people with as many adults who want to help them start businesses and get purpose aligned as possible. So definitely check out bridgemakers.org. And on your own time, think about becoming a mentee or a mentor, you know? So yeah.
I'm glad you decided you wanted to answer that one, Cole. That's a good one. Would anybody else like to answer? What elements would you add to our communities and networks that would make youth entrepreneurship more of a norm? Okay, let's move to the next question.
I would say one more thing. Youthprise, governments, large corporations, this feeds into Noah's points, money. You guys need to put the money out to create more programs. Folks like Bridgemakers, folks like Youthprise. I mean, when you're talking about these really, really, really large corporations, especially governments, governments can't do nothing but cut the check. I'm gonna be honest. They don't do much of anything else very well other than cutting that check. That's all we need from y'all, right? Large corporations, y'all might have a little bit of expertise, but you need to know when to give the expertise on logistics or whatever operations. And then you need to know when to step back because you're not from our community, right? So again, it comes mostly towards cutting the check. So I'm always say it straight. Show us the money. Where's the money, right? We need that safety net to fail. And we know that folks who fail are the ones that get it right the next time. So.
Excellent. Thank you, Cole. Cole's responding to the audience question. How can major corporations invest in young people? Kashua, please.
I was going to answer the piece about what systemic changes can we do to normalize young people sharing their voices. I think that's my answer to the question, but I think just even if it's not quite systemic, but even within the family system, like encouraging, and rather than like saying, oh, like, what have you accomplished today? More about like, hey, what did you see today? Like, what is something that you want to do? What are some dreams that you have? What is something that you're seeing in the community that you want to, like, what do you want to do about the problems that you see in the community that we live in? I think having those kinds of questions rather than, oh, like, how did you do on your test? How did you, you know, like, did you do good in school today? I think turning it into more of what did you see today, having them more focused on like creating and being curious. I think that's really, I think that benefits our community so much.
Excellent. I'm glad you went back there. That was great. That's great expertise. Athena, thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to just add on to that, like having incentives that encourage curiosity and encourage exploration for young people, I think is key. I had a summer program last year called Our Girl Action, and it included room for incentives for the participants, a financial incentive so that they could sustain themselves and whatever they wanted to explore, and not necessarily a specific practice, but just to have that incentive to encourage exploration, encourage becoming and being themselves, I think is really, really important, and making room for that in the budget.
Excellent. You know, one of the things that I often tell corporations is, what do you need? You need money, resources, time, right? Same thing communities need. Like, it's not a foreign concept. You're a human being and we're human beings. So what do human beings need? Food and water and such, you know, proper pay and such. So somebody asked about what's the best way to crowdsource funding for kidpreneurs and youthpreneurs. Does anybody have any ideas?
Yeah.
You didn't raise from before? Or it's still raised?
Oh, yeah. I was just going to answer that one as well. With my experience, I've used GoFundMe and other fundraising platforms and my network to just spread the word, to raise money for youth. And I feel that individual efforts definitely have a large impact in taking that time, having a long timeline for fundraising. and specific goals within the fundraising process is really key and can have an impact.
I'm so glad. Thank you. And Cole.
Yep. So I might be biased, but you know, this is kind of my ball game here, but Bridgemakers has the actual history of doing this, of being able to take money, bring it back into the development of young people and helping them see the returns on that by multiplying their money with the knowledge and skills that they've gained through our program. So you can donate directly to Bridgemakers. You can also reach out to us to see what happens with your money. What do we actually do with it? We can show you the curriculum. We can show you the kind of young people we work with. And then I swear Marcus didn't pay me to say this, but Youthprise. It's in their name. They're great at doing this, right? And that's actually what they've done here with the money they received is they've invested in us, the panelists, and other amazing young entrepreneurs. And I already know, as we've talked about, from, you know, how we're doing things differently, we are building businesses that are going and impacting our peers and bringing them more prosperity and bringing them a better quality of life and helping them get to the next level too. So that's how you can crowdsource for more young entrepreneurs is through us, right?
I think that's a very important point too. And I see you, Maya, we're coming right back to you. I think that's a very important point. We often tend to overlook what's already here in pursuit of something that we think, I don't know why we do that as human beings, but the investment opportunities are here. Hi, Maya.
It'll be Maya's mommy this time. So when I think about how we crowdfunded for her initial idea, Dad and I, we put some of the initial funding, but sometimes I think it's being willing to start small. So it's not always thinking I need 1,000 or I need to be able to buy such a big amount of products. Sometimes it's literally looking at what's the smallest amount that I can buy? What's the minimum order quantity that I can fill so that you can use that to generate those profits and push that back into their business and watch it replicate and exponentially grow. So sometimes it takes just a small seed, just a small amount, and then you're able to watch that grow.
Excellent. I'm glad Mom contributed. Thank you very much. Excellent. This is a big question to ask as we head into the end of the panel. So if you could just give, you know, I can't stand when people say a brief answer, but you know, so that you can get out your point. I want you to be able to make your point because I don't want to have to cut anybody off and we have just a few minutes. How are you all negotiating these wealth aspirations with critiques of an unsustainably structured economy and environmental decay? If we know that the economy is unsustainably structured, up for debate, they put in parentheses, why do we aspire to be incorporated into it? Why do we promote building businesses over discussions about mutual aid networks in our efforts to support our communities? Would anybody like to take that up?
You asked us to be brief on like the deepest question.
I hear you. They just gave it to me. I can't help it, Cole.
I'll be back in a minute. Let me think.
I totally dig your vibe. Okay, Kashua, talk, go ahead, please.
I think you have to really believe that your business idea or your project is good and it's doing and creating good. I think that you have to really be like, I'm behind this 100%. I think that this, I care a lot about doing good. So it's like, if my business is not doing good, then it's not worth investing. I shouldn't be asking people to be investing. The goal is to not make money. It's about to make money for myself at all. It's about, okay, well, how much money can I do so I can push it out and spread good in the community? And when I see the girls and women that like suddenly believe in themselves, are traveling the world, coming back transformed and uplifting their communities, it's like, okay, this is something that is worth investing in. And it's changing people's lives and their families and everything like that. So I think that's why, and like, I think having a business allows it to be like a hub for that. Mutual aid networks, like the networks need to have like hubs, like it can't just be a bunch of lines, it needs to have points of contact. And I think the businesses serve that purpose. But it is a fine line because when you are promoting a new business, unfortunately, my Hmong community, we're the victim of a lot of pyramid schemes. And so it's like, how do you make sure that my business does not become that? How do I make sure that my work is authentic and it's not hurting the people that I actually want to help? So I think that's kind of, and you have to make sure that your work is doing good and actually changing lives for the better. So that's just something I wanted to throw out.
Thank you very much, Kashua. Cole?
Kashua, you are so right. It really does come down to solving an actual problem and actually making people's lives better. That's real entrepreneurship, right? And we've conflated this word entrepreneurship with a lot of these corporations that actually make money exploiting people for the things that they need and jacking up prices for things that are like basic that we shouldn't need to get scalped on, right? And so there's exploitation everywhere, and you need to be aware of your duty as an entrepreneur to do good in your community. It has to start there. And the other thing I'll say is that I think mutual aid is important. Having a social safety net is important, and having supports for those who are less fortunate is very important. The other thing, entrepreneurship is also so beautiful because it allows you to take control over your journey of excellence and basically self-actualization. So no one is going to give you your self-actualization, right? No one is going to hand you who you are. You have to be that. You have to authentically come into the world as that. And if that's the person who is going to go and set out and cure cancer or do the next big thing, whatever it is, create that big difference and create that change. Entrepreneurship allows us a platform to do that in a way that's independent, authentic, and true to ourselves. And it really does always come back to that. You've got to be rooted in community. You've got to be rooted in good. You've got to be rooted in solving problems and helping people. And that's what we're here to do. That's why we're here. What a great panel, y'all. I'm sorry. This is so lit. Like, we just are coming out here with gems. All right.
Y'all are dropping some bombs in the best way, some knowledge bombs. This is awesome. Anybody else want to contribute to this question or have anything you'd like to say before we get ready to close? Do you want to maybe share a parting thought? Athena.
Yeah, I just wanted to say follow the funds, follow the money. I think it's really important to be aware of how people are using their funds, whether it's the corporations or peers, but if you do receive funds in any shape or form, whether it's through mutual aid or through a project or fundraising, looking at those funds and thinking, okay, how much can I save for the next thing, for sustainability, and then using those funds in a way that supports the needs that you don't have the capacity to support for free, and just really having a really intricate focus on where the money is going and how you want this money to propel you forward, I think is just a key element to highlight with this conversation.
Thank you, Athena. And Alondra Hajaratu, any last thought?
I think it really is just that idea of, again, doing this on our own terms, and especially as minorities. I am on DACA, so that means a lot to me that I know the system isn't set up for people like me who come here, but my business is my safety net. It's doing wealth on my own terms in a country that I know isn't set up for me to succeed. But, you know, these organizations, this is helping me get myself to where I see myself, even if it may not be readily available to me.
You know, I absolutely love this. It reminds me of let your model be resistance, that in entrepreneurship, we are resisting. We are creating agency for ourselves in a country which has not decided to create agency for us. And that is very inspiring for me. I hope that you're able to see the chat because you have inspired more than 95 people on this particular meeting. I know they're recording it, so they'll be sent all over the place and your gems of wisdom will be dropped in many places. We can help to create more wealth for these young people. We can invest in them. We can follow the things that they left for us to do. They have given us a roadmap, and this is our opportunity. I want to say thank you, Kashua. Thank you, Cole, Athena, Hajaratu, and Alondra, and Maya and Mom. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Youthprise, for centering youth voices and making youth-centered governance a verb. This is absolutely fantastic. I'm your host, Lissa Jones. I'm delighted to be your MC. I'm so glad to know you, Maya. Before we go, stay tuned to follow up on these youth entrepreneurs. We will be sharing more about their stories on the Youthprise blog and social media pages, right on. And we will also be launching another youth grant cycle in early 2023. Our partner, the Women's Foundation, has a Young Women's Innovator Grant open now. check the link in the chat. Young Women Innovating seems like we have some women who know about that on our panel. And last but not least, Youthprise is doing the Spread the Joy fundraiser again. The signups will be available in early November. To everyone who spent time with us this afternoon, President Pope, claiming our space, and to all the team who made this possible, thank you for centering youth voices and teaching us how to do that in a way that is meaningful and impactful. Thank you to the youth who came, and thank you for the opportunity to facilitate this very powerful conversation. Young Money, disrupting with purpose, spread the news everywhere. Thank you.
Cause look, you got me flying, cockpit, I'm so high.